Amen, but I say, let's just keep the amen for the end. Praise God. God bless you, everybody. It's good to be in God's house. Amen. Praise God. Praise God for Sundays. Sometimes you need a Sunday on a Monday. I know you do. Some days you need a Sunday all the week long, but you got through another week, everybody. Sunday is a gift from God to all mankind. He gives you a new start. Now, you can have a new start every moment of the day, but sometimes just the Sundays works, you know? And know this, everybody, as you walk through these doors, your sins are forgiven. Your past is forgotten. Today is a new day. Amen? Today is a new day. You are clean. You are clean. Go ahead and live like it. Amen? You are forgiven. Go ahead and live like it. You're loved. Go ahead and live like it. You have a God. Live like you have a God. Please. Please live like you have a God. Sometimes it's hard to even get a smile on a face. Like, don't you know you have a God? Yeah. All right. You know, we're still excited about Seeds of Tomorrow. Definitely called by God. May God bless them, right? We always pray, may the next generation's always got to be greater, everybody. So you got to give them what you got. You better put what you got into somebody else, because you ain't going to be here forever. We're not sending you off yet, but take it and give it to somebody. The next generation must be greater. Must be greater. God bless you. You know, we are studying the book of Genesis this year. And those of you who are not able to come on our Wednesdays, I'd say you're not missing much. We're only in the eighth chapter, okay? No, you're missing it. Now, we're doing a chapter a month, and so we'll be doing that for the next 40 years. So please come. All right. Did you look in your bulletins today? Do you know we make them and offer them at the front? What's our title of our conversation today? Get out of the ark, everybody. Get out of the ark. You know, God loves you. And he has a real plan for your life. He sees you. He cares about you. Every detail of your life. You know, you walk in these doors on a Sunday for a reason, you know. And whatever that reason may be, ultimately, you know, we're looking for something. We're just looking for something. God, love, people, friends, whatever. And you'll find it. You'll find it in him, you know. So God loves you. He watches over you. He cares about the smallest details of your life. Sometimes it seems like, does anybody see me or know me? And God cares about the very last small detail of your life. And not only that, everybody, God is not satisfied with that. He wants to do extraordinary things in your life. You know that? He doesn't want you to just get by. Man, life is large, and he wants to do extraordinary things in your life. You know, you look at the title of our conversation today. The title is Get Out of the Ark, or Go Out of the Ark. We're in the book of Genesis, and we're talking about the flood of Noah and how God told Noah and his family to get on the ark because he's about to flood the earth, right? And he was in that ark. God said, the last thing that God said to him was, get on the ark. So he got on the ark. And you know, how long did it rain? Do you know how long it rained? 40 days and 40 nights. But they were in that ark longer than 40 days and 40 nights. They were in that ark for just about 1 year. 1 year on a boat. Long time. And so much happened in that year, and the whole, you know, face of the earth was washed away, and it seems, biblically speaking, that God did not speak to Noah for that 1 year. He said, get on the ark, and then he said nothing for the next year. Like you said, Pastor Phil, I liked your humorous analogy of the ark a couple of weeks ago, because it's real life. And here we are about a year later, and God finally speaks to Noah again. And I do believe that God wants to speak to you. I believe that God wants to speak to you. Do you believe that? Has God ever spoken to you? By a raise of hands. Has God ever spoken to you? And you know, those of you who haven't raised your hands, I'm going to say this. God has spoken to you. We just don't, we don't realize it. We don't know it. But God speaks to you. He created you because he wants to talk to you. He wants to tell you, of course, that he loves you, but he wants to guide you through this life. He wants to give you what he's got. You know, God's got everything, and then it was nothing unless he had somebody to give it to. So he made a family, and he wants to give you what he's got. He wants to give you his knowledge and his wisdom. You ever have a parent that wants to pass on knowledge and wisdom to a child? Don't you know God wants to give that to you? It's like, sit down, boy. Sit down, girl. I want to give you something. And God does talk to us. And I don't care how young or how old you are. Sometimes when we think we're older, that God doesn't want to do new things in our lives anymore. Like sometimes we're just counting the days. And God says, I'm not done. If you got breath in your lungs, God is not done with you. And God wants to do extraordinary things in your life. He wants to speak to you. At whatever age you are, he says, I want to do something new in your life. God is so big, he cannot be fully dispensed. He said, can I give you something else? I got this massive wealth, and I barely cracked the door of one entrance to this massive wealth. Does anybody want it? Yeah, okay, good. I got one reason. Does anybody want my wealth? I want to give it to you. So a year later, God spoke to Noah once again. So if you have your Bibles, if not, Brother Keith helps us. We're going to read from the book of Genesis, chapter 8. We'll read a couple of verses about Noah and God finally speaking to him again. It says in verse 15 of chapter 8, it says, then God spoke to Noah. They were on the boat for a year. And he said this. He said, go out of the ark, you and your wife and your sons and their wives. There was eight of them, right? Bring out every living thing. Remember, there was two of every animal. Bring out every living thing of all flesh that is with you. The birds, the cattle, the creeping things, right? Everything that creeps on the earth, so that they may abound on the earth. God wanted this earth to be filled again, that they may abound on the earth and be fruitful and multiply upon the earth. Leave that up for a second. That is always the plan of God. God wants you, at wherever you are in your life, he wants you to be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth. Fill the earth with good things. You know that? Does anybody know that? Yeah, that's right. And God spoke to Noah. You know, there's many examples in the Bible where it seems like God was silent. Has anybody ever heard the story about the Hebrew slaves that lived in Egypt for like 400 years? Anyone hear the story about that? And then God finally raised up a deliverer. His name was, I forget his name. What was his name? Moses, that's it. And you know, God told Jacob and his family, go down to Egypt because I want you to stay there for a while. I'm going to feed you and clothe you and give you houses over there. So they were all excited. Okay, we're going to Egypt. Let's pack up. We're going to Egypt. They stayed there for 400 years. And in 400 years, it seemed like God stopped. Like God told them to move and go there. And then he stopped talking to them. For 400 years, God didn't talk to them. You ever go through times in your life where it seems like God is not talking to you? It's planned. And 400 years later, Moses is walking in the desert, and he sees the burning bush, right? And God calls him to that burning bush, and God says, he says this, he says, I've heard the cry of my people. I've seen their sorrow, and I've seen their suffering. It was 400 years worth, everybody. How old are you? No one's older than 400, are you? You got nothing to complain about. Nothing. Get out of here, all of you. Get out of here. 400 years. God, what are you doing in my life? 400 years later, God told Moses, I've heard their cry. And you know he's heard every one of your cries. You know, Bible says that he collects your tears. You may have forgotten your tears. God didn't forget them. God collected them in a bottle. You might have forgotten some of your sorrow and some of your pain. God didn't. God didn't. He says, I know the sorrow and the pain that you went through. And I know the tears that you cried. And I heard your prayers and your desperation. And although times got better and you forgot some of your pain, God said, I'm still going to make it up to you. He says, I'm a good God. I love you. I know the sacrifices that you made. And I know the waiting that you had. And God says, you might have even forgotten your sacrifices. But God says, I haven't. Isn't that amazing to you? Isn't that amazing? Because you might even get over some of the stuff and you say, God, okay, I'm all right. It's okay. We got through it. It was tough. It's okay. I'm good. God says, no. No, I haven't forgotten. I haven't forgotten the path that you walked. I haven't forgotten. 400 years later, God says to Moses, I heard their cry. And I've seen their sorrow and their affliction, and it's come up before me, and it's time. Moses, it's time. God sends Moses to Egypt. Wasn't he a powerful man, right? Powerful man in Egypt. Goes up to the strongest nation on earth, Pharaoh himself, and defies him by the name of the Almighty. You may have held my brothers and sisters in slavery for 400 years, but we're busting out of here. I don't care what you do. What you do cannot make me afraid. I stood in front of that burden bush. There ain't nothing you can pull out of your bags or tricks that's going to make me afraid. I was with Almighty. He spoke to me. He gave me a mandate from heaven. There's nothing you can do that can shake me. I'm sent by God. And he tried it. Pharaoh tried it. Pharaoh took his staffs, right, threw them on the ground. They became serpents. Ha! Moses says, oh, yeah. Throws this on the ground. His serpent swallows up their serpents, picks up his rod. Psh. Okay, now where were we? Let my people go. You know, when the writers wrote the Old Testament, does anybody know the last book of the Bible, the last book of the Old Testament? Does anybody know that one? Yes, Revelation, yes. Yes. How about the last book of the Old Testament? Malachi. Some of you refer to it as Malachi. That's only because you thought he was an Italian man. He wasn't. He was a Hebrew prophet. No Malachi. But this is an Italian prophet that lived during the times of... You know, after it seemed like there were so many prophets, man. You guys, powerful prophets in the Old Testament. You had Jeremiah and Ezekiel, right? Had Elijah and Elisha, and so many powerful prophets, and all of the minor prophets and major prophets. And Malachi was the last of them all. And he wrote his book, and in his book, he said, "Listen, Christ is coming, everybody." He got the nation up on edge. He got them on their toes. He gets, "Is everybody listening?" Malachi said, "Do I have your attention?" He said, Christ is coming. He's coming as a refiner's as fire and as full as soap. He said, no one can stand when he comes. The day of the Lord is terrible and great. Are you ready for the coming of the Lord? And they all cried out, we're ready, Malachi, we're ready. And then nothing happened for 400 years. 400 years, nothing happened. There wasn't another prophet since the great Malachi. There wasn't another voice to be heard. Christ was not born until 400 years later. Huh. I mean, there are some times when God seemingly does not talk. But God has brought us to a point, and know why you're here today, because God says, I want to speak to you again. Amen. I want to speak to you again. It says, and God spoke. He spoke to him. You got your Bibles again? Look at Hebrews. Hebrews 1:1. I'm going to read it in the King James Version first because I grew up with that and I love this version. And then I'm going to read it in words that actually make sense to us. But Hebrews 1:1 in the King James Version, it says this of Jesus when he finally came to the earth. It says, God, who at sundry times and in divers manners spoke in times past unto the fathers by the prophets, hath in these last days spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed heir of all things, by whom also he made the worlds. Anybody know that one? Hebrews 1:1, the King James Version. You like that one? Pastor Phil, right? Yeah, you're all King James guy. Yeah, I know that. Everybody else wasn't talking to me, so I figured, hey, Philly boy. Okay, let's read it in a understandable translation. NIV. It says, in the past, God spoke to our forefathers through prophets at many times and in various ways. But in these last days, he's spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed heir of all things, and through whom he made the universe. Now, I know God has spoken to you guys in the past. I asked you to raise your hand before. I said, has God ever spoken to you? Most of you raised your hand. Those of you who did not raise your hand, I know he spoke to you. You just didn't recognize it was him that was speaking to you. And God does do wonderful things in our lives, and he brings us through periods of wildernesses, if you will, of times when he's not speaking, of arc experiences. He hides you away. He tucks you away. He seemingly causes you to be forgotten because he's doing something really beautiful now, okay? And he just sometimes just needs you to get out of the way. True, right. And then it says, now he says, I'm going to speak again. But he said, God said, I used to speak to you through the prophets and in various ways. But he says, I want to speak to you in a way, if you can hear this, okay? I don't care how young or how old you are. If you can hear this. God says, I want to speak to you in a way I never spoke to you before. Now, I know how God used to talk to you. God used to talk to me like through the Bible. I'd read the Bible and I'd hear him. Anybody? Sometimes through meditation, like you have a thought or an idea, but you know it's God. Anybody? Sometimes he speaks through signs, right? Like you ever just like see a commercial or hear somebody speak or something flash in front of you and it was like a confirmation of what you know God was talking to you. But God says, I want to speak to you again, but I want to speak to you like I've never spoken to you before. And it seems in times past he's spoken to us through other people and through other methods. But God wants to speak to you in a real powerful way. He wants to speak to you. I don't exactly know exactly how, but it's like direct and powerful. The one who made the universe himself will deal directly with you. He would not deal with another person for you. He would deal directly to you. And he says, this is what I want you to do. This is what you're going to do. And this is going to change everybody around you. Like you are the Moses that he calls to the mountain that says, come here, man, come here. I got to talk to you. And there's like a face-to-face kind of thing with God. There's something face-to-face that God does with you. And then it's a time of maturity where you don't question it. You're not the immature ones anymore where you say, God, I need you to speak to me. Cha-cha-cha. I mean, that's cool, but God says, no. That's the times past. You're going to know me. I will stir your spirit and you will stand to attention and say, yes, Lord, I know that's you. I know that's you. What? What, Lord? Yes, Lord. Amen. And he will speak to you, and you will know it's God, and nothing will shake you. I don't need a sign. I don't need somebody to confirm it. I don't need a truck to drive by me with the same word that God talked to me that morning. I don't need nothing. I have the word of the Lord. What's the confirmation? The Spirit of God that dwells inside of you is the confirmation. Spirit of God is the witness that says, yup, that's God, go. Where do you think Moses got his confirmation? He went directly to Pharaoh, bold and strong, nothing shaking him. But God wants to speak to you in a way he's never spoken to you before. And he wants to take us out of our immaturity, our wishy-washy immaturity. Well, we say, okay, God, confirm it. Okay, God, is that really you? You know it's him. Come on now, everybody in this room, come on now. I cannot tell you how many times I have asked God to talk to me, and I know he said to me, Mike, I already talked to you. I come and I ask for a message. He said, I already gave it to you. What are you doing tearing that Bible apart? Put it down for a second. I already talked to you. God has already talked to you. He's already put a word in your heart. God is not hard, everybody. He's not hard. He's easy. You have a thought. You have an idea. You have a feeling. It is God Almighty that works from the inside of you. Right? And it's by acknowledging that you say, yes, Lord, then it's expanded. No doubt. No doubt. When you doubt, you say, God never talks to me. Only because we doubt, but he does. We're just immature. It's okay. But there's a knowing that says he'll speak to you by the voice of his son in a new way where there's no doubt. You hear God just opens his mouth and you say, yes, Lord, yes, Lord. And then with the acknowledgement of it, knowing that he's talking to you, knowing it's God, because you're not a child anymore, it's expanded and it grows and it becomes bigger and bigger. And then all of a sudden you got one word, now you got the whole plan. Okay, got it, Lord, got it. Can I get an amen? Can I get a yes, Lord? Thank you, Jesus. Yep. Come on, you're not children anymore. He's not going to talk to you like he did in the past. Does anybody here know God? Because you can't change the world if you don't know God. The world don't know God. You know God. You were called by him to bring God to the world. I know the world don't know him, but you know him. It's the biggest, greatest thing you got. It's why you were born, and it's what you were designed for. It's nothing you earned. It's something he gave you. So I choose you. I will give you all of my glory, all of my resources. I will give you my name. Now go give it to him. He said, who will I say sent me? He said, say, what did he say? I am that I am. I am the only one. I am the sun, the moon, the stars. I'm the air you breathe. I'm the sun that sets at night. And I'm the one that wakes you up in the morning. I'm the one that puts breath in your body and lets you stand up. Who am I? I am everything. And go and tell them everyone and everything the I am sent me. Where there's no question and no doubt. Who sent me? Oh my goodness, life sent me. Right? He gave you his name. The world don't know him. Go tell him who he is. You know him. You know him. He called you. He raised you in church. He brought you to Sunday school from a young age. Why? You know him. There are some who's never heard his name, and you have an abundance of it. Why do you think you have an abundance of it? You don't even know how powerful the God is that you got. You think you're struggling in your life as if your life is a struggle. Your life isn't a struggle. It's powerful. Get out of yourself, man. Your life is powerful. You are sent by God. Stop crying in your desert. Get out of your ark and go, man. Go as God has sent you to go. Amen to that. Amen to that. God says, I will speak to you in a way I've never spoken to you, but I'm not going to speak to you like a child. I'm not going to speak to you like a child. You're not going to question every word I say. You're not going to doubt whether it's me or not, doubt whether I do this or that. You're going to know me. Praise God. He gets out of the ark, or God calls him out of the ark, and then God says this to Noah. God says this to Noah. It's in verse 17, I think. Genesis 8, he says, maybe it's later on, I don't know. But he says, be fruitful and multiply, right? He says, you get out of the ark. You get out. Kicks you out. He said, be fruitful and multiply. Now, you know, that's the same mandate that God gave Adam and Eve. You remember that when God first created mankind? What did God say to them? Same thing. He said, be fruitful and multiply. He said, subdue the earth, take dominion, right? Sure he did. Now, God says this to you and I. You know, he says, take dominion. He gives you the earth, and he says, take dominion. And primarily what God is telling you and I to take dominion, well, we're all happy to take dominion over people and take dominion over finances. Oh, we take dominion over finances. I'm going to be rich. Shut up. I just shut up already. Crying about your money. And why don't you really take dominion? God says, I call you to take dominion. Dominion over what? Right here, baby. Over this right here. Take dominion over your thoughts. I know you're all strong and powerful and successful enough to amass riches, but can you take dominion over your thoughts? I know we're chasing the wind, but why don't we stop for a while? God says, take dominion over what? Your thoughts. We allow all kinds of thoughts in our head. We allow it. Because we're stuck on ourselves, that's all. Because we're young and immature. And we allow ourselves to think things that we wouldn't dare speak or live. And sometimes you think them enough, you do speak them and live them. That's why I get it in the beginning. God's looking for a powerful, mature people. He wants to call you out of the ark. He wants you to take hold of this new world. He wants you to subdue it. He wants you to be fruitful and multiply. And he says this, everybody, if you're grown up enough, if I'm grown up enough, and this is all by the power of God, but God does work in us and through us. He says this, everybody, he takes us to a new day, and in your new day, he says, take control of your thoughts. There are some thoughts that you have, stop, cast them down. Refuse to think about them. Stop letting your mind run wild over things you know will never happen and should never happen. I know we want to take dominion over the world. God says to take dominion over your thoughts. And I love that because that empowers me to do it. Listen, this is not condemnation for me and for you. It empowers me. Like some things, sometimes I just think I'm hopeless and I'm just subjected to my thoughts and I can't help it. I just can't help it. That's how I think. I don't know how you that's me on a daily basis. But the Lord says, no, take dominion. And be strong in your thoughts. And be sound in your thoughts. You know very well that you can take dominion over your speech. You know in front of certain people, you don't say certain things, right? Because you can take dominion over your tongue. Same thing for your thoughts. There's certain things you don't have to think and you shouldn't think. Don't think them. And sometimes we like to indulge ourselves in our thought life because no one can see. But we're the casualty of thoughts that are not taken. We're the casualty. We're the ones that are a mess and confused and emotional and a wreck. You take dominion over your thoughts. Take dominion over your emotions. I like that. I like that. I like that God says take dominion because he says take dominion over your desires. Take dominion over your affections, if you will. Take dominion. You know, we want to be these big, rich, beautiful, successful Christians. Okay, take dominion. Take dominion over your emotions. Take dominion over your desires. Things that grab hold of you and then tell you to go here and go there, you tell them no. No. Right? In a world that says you got to be true to your feelings, God says your feelings are a lie. Your feelings, our emotions are a lie. I came to save you because your feelings is your soul. I came to save you from your soul because your soul's been lying to you your whole life. I feel this. I like this. I want this. I know it's lying to you. Your feelings, your emotions, your desires, your affections need to be saved by God Almighty. He came to save your soul. I say, okay, Lord, okay. Now, it's just you understanding this and acknowledging it, maybe even giving an amen, but then you're going to need the Almighty to do that for you. You're going to need the Almighty, all right? But he says, be fruitful and multiply. He says, take dominion. Take dominion over what? Take dominion over all of this going on here. And in this new day, God says to you again, because sometimes, you know, we let ourselves go and our self-indulgence and our self-pity and our self. And God says, listen, take dominion again. You're entering the new world. God wants to do something new in your life. Take dominion. Get hold of yourself. I don't know about you. You guys can fall asleep on this word. I need this. I need God to come into my life and tell me again, take dominion, Michael. You can do it. Take dominion. Cut it out already. Take dominion over your thoughts and your desires and your actions. Take dominion. I gave you my power. Take dominion. And stop being a helpless one, just led astray by every wind and thought and feeling, and get a hold of yourself. There's nothing ungodly about that. You know, and then, you know, I like it that God always says, like even in the beginning, God made man and he put him inside the Garden of Eden, right? And then he told him to take dominion. You know what the man was supposed to do? What we're supposed to do is the Garden of Eden wasn't the whole planet. You know, there was just like a little section of the earth that was called the Garden of Eden, right? Wherever it was, I don't know. Does anybody know where the Garden of Eden was? I don't know. We watch our doctor. I don't know where it was. It was in Alva. Very interesting. That's one theory I've never heard. But it makes sense. But now it's making sense. All you people from Alva just got your chest ripped up. Okay, thank you for that. So since it was an Alva, it's your fault that it didn't get outside of Alva. Because purpose was given to man, because they were supposed to take Eden and cover the globe with Eden. God said, here's paradise, here's heaven, if you will. Now cover the globe with it. And even, you know, we see God is showing us not to see failure in the garden, because all too often we see failure, the fall of man, sin, darkness, devil, blah. Okay, I kind of think that God has a plan and nothing usurps his plan. I kind of think that God is really almighty and not just like this small. I think he's like really powerful, kind of. I don't think he's got a plan and a purpose, and I don't think God fails from day one. That's just me, though. What about you? I don't think God failed from the go. I think the plan of God was to get Adam and Eve out of the garden, because they had to make the rest of the world like the garden. They had to go, take dominion, subdue. When God called Noah out of the ark, you know what they did? They settled there, and God told Noah and all his descendants, you're not settling here. I want you to go cover the globe. Right? And he said, go west. And they went west for a while. But then King Nimrod rose up and found this place called Shinar, Babylon, if you will. And he said, let's stay here. Let's stay here in Babylon. Let's build a temple here. Let's build a place of worship here. But God said, I didn't tell you to stay there. I said, I told you to keep on going. I want you to go and make the whole earth, subdue the whole earth, and make it like the Garden of Eden, right? And this was always God's plan. God wants you to go and make the world like the Garden of Eden. Now listen, everybody. God is calling you, and I think he's calling me, to get out of the ark. What's the ark? The ark is the old life that you've lived. God wants to do something new in your life. I don't know where you've come from. You might be coming from a great place or a mediocre place or a hard place. But God wants to do something new in your life, okay? God, can I get a better amen than that? God wants to do something new in your life. He's ready. He said, I've been silent for 400 years, and I'm ready to do something new in your life. And now you're going to hear my voice again. You're going to hear my voice again. And I'm telling you, the place where you're at in life, you're not staying there anymore. And you're going to need the help of the Almighty, because we need some help moving sometimes. We kind of like it where we're at. And God says, get out of the ark. Amen. I know God's calling us out of the ark again. And sometimes, you know, we won't get out of the ark unless it's just right. You know, like when you like jumping into the pool, you want to test the pool. If it's not just, no, I'm not getting in that. Nope, that's a little too cold for me. Listen, when God tells you to get out of the ark, the circumstances that God wants you to walk into might not be great. It might not be wonderful. You might not see the light of day. It's not supposed to. God is sending you into a wilderness that has, I know you made your world nice and pretty. I mean, like, you know what you're doing on a Monday. You know what you're doing on a Tuesday. You have your patterns. You have your way of living. You have your... Is there any human beings in the house? You have the way you live your life. You have the way you think, the way you act. We all have phrases, too. This is what I do. This is who I am. When I do this, I do this. Everybody in the house says that. And God says, I don't want that to be you anymore. But we say, but that's who I am. That's who you were. You want something wonderful from God, he's got to change your life entirely. But I'm comfortable with this. It's over. Jesus. I know this. I do this well. Yeah, and you're in the same rut you've always been. You want to get out of your rut? I'm going to change what you like. I'm going to change how you feel. You're not going to live. He says, get out of your ark. But he made it real comfortable in here. I painted the inside of the ark. I painted it with a nice black pitch. I kind of like my ark. He says, I'm going to like sell the ark, destroy the ark. We're getting rid of the ark. Get out of the ark. And you're not stepping into the Garden of Eden. You're stepping into a wilderness. And he says, go make that wilderness the Garden of Eden. Go make that new world beautiful. Right? That's the plan. Because we've been like children. We want to go from one nice place to another nice place. Oh, this is really nice. Hey, that's nice. Okay. God says, I don't need you to do that. He says, you are the sons of God. You are the morning stars. You are the Elohim upon the earth. I told you to go take dominion. I told you not to go into the Garden of Eden. I birthed you in the garden so you know what it's like. Now go out into the wilderness and make a Garden of Eden out of it. God calls you into the wilderness and says, turn that into a garden, would you? He brings you to someplace ugly. He says, make that beautiful, would you? Oh, yeah. He throws you into a mess and he says, can you organize this for me? God the Father says, can you organize that for me? Because, you know, the whole universe belongs to God. And he says, can you go make that room beautiful for me over there? And can you rebuild that over there for me? Can you make this really nice over here? Can you go fix that situation for me over here? I got a little something going on. Can you go over there and take care of that? Right? I birthed you in Eden. Take dominion. Go into the wilderness and make a garden. But you got to know the voice of God. You got to know God sent you there. That's why, number one, you got to know God's voice. You got to be real strong and confident. You can't be a child. Otherwise, halfway through, Moses would have ran out of Egypt with his tail tucked between his legs. Right? You better believe it, man. Snakes chasing him right out of First sign of trouble. What do you mean the first sign of trouble? There was trouble after trouble after trouble. Moses, I ain't leaving without him. And then Pharaoh would say, okay, you can take like just the men only. I ain't leaving without him. Well, you can take just this only. Just Moses, I'm taking every single one of them. And I'll stay here until fire falls from the sky, but we're doing what my God said we're doing. I am going to make this desert like the Garden of Eden, not if it kills me, if it kills you. And you say, I don't have that kind of fortitude. I don't have that kind of determination. I'm not that strong. Yes, you are. Because the Word of God makes that. The Word of God makes you strong. Isn't it true? I mean, you and I...